Good morning, and welcome to St. Philip Church. As we celebrate the 15th Sunday of ordinary time. Next weekend is 4:30 p.m. Saturday. The Mass will be live streaming on our website and Facebook. The 9 a.m. Mass on Sunday will not be live streaming, but recorded through the Google Mass will be available. This morning, the Mass is offered for
thank you. God, who through the grace of adoption chose us to be children of light, grant, we pray, that we may not be wrapped in the darkness of error, but always be seen to stand in the bright light of truth. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the second book of Kings. One day, Elisha came to Shunem, where there was a woman of influence who urged him to die. Afterward, whenever he passed by, he used to stop there to die. So she said to her husband, "I know that Elisha is a holy man of God. Since he visits us often, let us arrange a room on the roof and furnish it for him with a bed, table, chair, and a lamp, so that when he comes to us, he can stay there." Sometime later, Elisha cried and stayed in the room overnight. Later, Elisha asked, "Can somebody come to her?" His servant, Gehazi, answered, "Yes. She has no son, and her husband is getting on in years." Elisha said, "Call her." When the woman had been called and stood at the door, Elisha promised, "This time next year, you will be one of them who gave you son." The word of the Lord. "Forever I will sing the goodness of the Lord. The promises of the Lord are the same forever. Through all generations, my mouth will proclaim your faithfulness. For you have said, my kindness is established forever. In heaven, you have confirmed your faithfulness." Blessed the people who know the joyful shout. In the light of your confidence, O Lord, they walk. At your name, they rejoice all the day. And through your justice, they are exalted. You are the splendor of your strength, and by your favor, our horn is exalted. For to the Lord belongs our shield, and to the Holy One of Israel, our King. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. "Brothers and sisters, are you unaware that we were baptized in Christ Jesus? Were baptized into his death? We were indeed buried with him through baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live in newness of life. If then we have died with Christ, we believe we shall also live with him. We know that Christ, raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has power over him. After his death, he died in sin once and for all. As to his life, he lives for God. Consequently, you too must think of yourself as dead to sin and living for God in Christ Jesus." The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
And whoever does not take up his cross or follow after me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Whoever receives you receives me, and whoever receives me receives the one who sent me. Whoever receives a prophet because he is a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And whoever receives a righteous man because he is a righteous man will receive a righteous man's reward. And whoever gives only a cup of cold water to one of these little ones to drink, because the little one is a disciple, amen, I say to you, he will surely not lose his reward. The Gospel. Just a couple of introductory remarks before I give my homily. First of all, I think this is the first Mass since last March when we were forced to not have public Mass. I think this is the first Mass of all of the Masses where we've actually maxed out on the amount of people that we're allowed to have in the church at this time. It's nice to see that because I think more and more we hope that all of our three Masses will at least reach capacity, and at a certain point we look forward to when we'll be able to increase that number, whatever that might be. It would have been another nice morning for an outdoor Mass today, but you never know what the weather is going to be like, and as it gets hotter, we have to think about where we're going to do that, because that pavement will be awfully warm when it's 90, 95 degrees outside, so we're working on that right now. The other thing is that I'm standing here because I was hoping that this microphone, for those who are watching online, will pick up a little better. I posted online a little while ago that today I turned off all the fans in the front, but turned on the ones in the back. And as I put online, I said, I can't make everybody happy today. Either people in here will be mad because the fans are off in the front, or people at home will be mad because the fans are on and they can't hear. So I said, I'll aim for 50-50 and do the very best that I can. So to everybody online, it's best I can do. And to everybody else here, it's best I can do. But great to have all of us here and so many this morning. As you all know, I've made many trips and each year go to the Mayo Clinic for my issues with epilepsy and other things related to that. And a couple of years ago, on one of my trips, I sort of tuned into something that I noticed already, but I hadn't really given it a whole lot of thought, so I tested it out. And what I noticed was how it was that people were not always very, very good at extending themselves to others. Let me explain what I mean. First of all, I don't mean the clinic itself. The clinic itself is one of the most incredible places I've ever seen or heard of that is so welcoming and helpful to people. But if you've never been there, you have to know how large this place is. We hear the word clinic. It's nothing like a clinic. It's not even hospital. It's massive. And so thousands of people are going there every day for their various tests, regular doctor's appointments, or all the way to very, very serious things that some very professional experts will take a look at. And so you can imagine how many people are filing by everybody else when there are so many people there. And the city itself is connected by skywalks. And so as you go through the skywalks, you're passing all kinds of people. My appointments oftentimes I try to schedule or they're early in the morning. And so there aren't quite as many people at 6:30 or 7 or 7:30 in the morning as there is closer to lunchtime. And so this is what I started to notice. It's just sort of a habit of mine, I guess. I hope it's a good habit, that unless I have something, whatever else going on, as I walk down the skywalks or in the clinic, you just turn, and I hope all of us in our regular routine just kind of go, hello, or a little smile, or a little nod as people are going by. And I noticed that I didn't see that as much. And so I did a little test the last time that I was there. And I would go along and I would just kind of nod or say hello or some kind of gesture to just be welcoming, hospitable, greeting, something like that. And it took me 42 people before the first person acknowledged it back. Other people would either automatically look down or just not be paying attention at all. Now, certainly there are circumstances. Obviously, if you're maybe someone that works there, you're in a hurry, maybe thinking about your day, and you just kind of keep going. Clearly, there are people who are very worried about whatever their tests are that day or whatever's going on in their lives. But I just began to notice how easy it was for everyone just to sort of tune out and not really be there in any kind of way with or for one another. Then I began thinking about that in terms of our circumstances now. I mean, here I look out and everybody is wearing their masks as they're required to do. And I noticed at the grocery store this last week, I noticed that as I had my mask on and was walking through picking up a couple of things, not only can we really no longer give a little smile or a hello, but that also translates into that disconnect of some kind. And so in other words, when I put my mask on, I can try with my eyes to show that I'm saying hello or smiling or greeting. But right now, I have no idea if you are all sneering at me right now, if you're enjoying this immensely, if you have your mask on and you're whispering to the person next to me, "I wish you'd hurry up, it's warm in here." I have no idea, and none of us do. We don't know what's going on as much as we can because we can't even see each other any longer. And I thought about that with our readings today, especially the first reading and in the Gospel. To sort of paraphrase and summarize that first reading, we hear about the prophet Elisha, sometimes pronounced Elisha, but also Elisha. And Elisha is a prophet, as we hear of so many prophets, and they're called by the Lord to go and to teach the way the Lord instructs. And to sort of paraphrase, Elisha is doing what he's supposed to be doing, and there's a woman, a wealthy woman, who welcomes him into her home, she and her husband's home, and he stays there with them as he's traveling from place to place. Now remember, it's not like us traveling from place to place. We can get in a car and drive over to Detroit or to the lake or whatever it might be very easily. And we probably have the air conditioning on in the car as we go. But for a prophet in the time of Elisha, that's not the case. You're traveling by foot, maybe by caravan, and certainly not in the best weather conditions in terms of not being able to turn the air conditioning on your horse or your donkey on your way. And so it's a different story altogether. Well, anyway, so Elisha is making these journeys, and it gets to the point that the husband and the wife are so grateful and so glad to see Elisha, they build a room for him. And so he stays there. Talk about hospitality. They appreciate what he does, and he appreciates what they're doing for him. So he asks the question, "Is there something I can do for them?" And their servant says, "Well, maybe this couple don't have children. He's getting along in years, and it just doesn't seem to be very likely." And so Elisha prophesies that at the time that he returns, they will be holding their child. And sure enough, later on, we find out that that's the case. So I'm not suggesting that we be hospitable towards one another so we have more babies. That's not what I'm suggesting. But what I am suggesting is that hospitality that went on between the couple and Elisha, is something that I think we need to really start to think more about and be creative about. Because we live now in a world that seems to be more divided, and we're pretty good at yelling at each other, but we're losing, I think, in many cases, that extension of one another. And now, unfortunately, but necessarily, we wear these masks, and we even have lost more, and we have a bigger wall between us and other people. So we have to be creative in that sense. Jesus in the Gospel gives a whole different list of things. He says, for example, "Whoever receives me receives the one who sent me." Or another example, "Whoever gives one of these little ones, because they are a disciple, a cold cup of water, he also is one who is being received by me, and therefore received by the Father." And he gives all kinds of examples along those ways. In other words, when we are extending ourselves, when we are reaching out to one another in ways that we really need to be doing, we're reaching the Son and God the Father. And so we need to be creative nowadays.
and think about ways in which we might be able to do that. We may be thinking about family members that we really can't visit very often or at all because of their own vulnerability or their own health situation. So we need to be creative. Creative, whether it be a telephone call or instant messaging or whether it be on Zoom or on GoToMeeting or one of the Google, whatever it might be, we need to be more creative. Or maybe there are things we've never done before. I'm terrible at writing letters. And so maybe that's a way to maybe extend ourselves in a creative way so that we are appreciating the fact that we're here for and with one another. I think today, maybe more than for a very long time, we need to be even more careful about the way we speak to, reach out, and interact with one another. Because right now, there are lots of barriers between us. Lots of them that have happened that we don't have much choice, either because of what we are asked or told to do, or simply because it's the right thing to do right now. We are really good at sometimes putting the barriers up and not recognizing that we have to knock them down. And that applies to so many different things nowadays. But to do so in a calm, Christian, happy way, a way in which is hospitable, a way in which we are really, truly reaching out as Christ would want us to do. So today as we celebrate this 13th Sunday in Ordinary Time, and as we have a church full in terms of what we are allowed to have with people, let's all pray that we think about ways in which we can be more like that couple in the first reading, who extended themselves way out to Elisha the prophet, or listening to what Jesus says about how we can receive one another, and therefore if we're receiving one another, they're receiving the Lord. And when we receive the Lord, we receive the one who sent the Lord. We need to discover that once again. We need to focus on it once again, maybe more than ever. And then when we do, then we'll find the results that we are looking for, and we'll find that connection that I think we all so longly desire. Praise be Jesus Christ. Stand up and profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us men and for our salvation. Came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Asking God to hear and answer our many needs and the needs of others, we present these prayers.
That all who are not baptized will, through the preaching of the church, be led to accept the grace of all of God to receive a new life. We pray for the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have been made young by the coronavirus, for all who care for them, and for the governments and the people of the world, that we may experience the healing mercy of the Lord. We pray for the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That Christians who serve us in government may place their loyalty to Christ above every political and personal loyalty. We he comes to us, the stranger, the sick, the imprisoned, and the unborn child. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are far from the sacraments, that have trusted God to forgive us, we may confess their sins and join us in them at the table of the Eucharist. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all in our parish, for families who are sick, and for our departed loved ones, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Loving God, we make all of our prayers and our petitions to you through Christ our Lord.
Thank you.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Thank you.
just as a reminder, since we weren't in the church last week, or some may be here for the first time since coming back to 9 o'clock Mass, communion is a little bit different, just as a reminder. So I'll begin over in section one against the wall over here, but you'll start from the back. The ushers will help you come forward. You'll receive communion across the front and down the center aisle back to your seats. When this section's done, I'll come over, we'll do this section. Section two, you just do what you normally do. And section three, you just do what you normally do. And then when everyone's clear, I'll start section four from the back, and you'll go down the center aisle back to your seats. Okay, the ushers are around now. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter on the Lamb, but only say the word. Thank you.
Thank you.
Let us pray. May this divine sacrifice we have offered and received fill us with life, O Lord, we pray, so that bound to you in lasting charity, we may bear fruit that lasts forever through Christ our Lord. Just again, thank you. It's so great to be able to reach maximum. Our number is right at 114 is what we can do right now as a capacity. We'll continue the sign-ups. It's really important to try to do them. We do have a list when someone comes in if they haven't signed up, but the numbers are the numbers. If it becomes necessary, we can do overflow in another location, in a cafeteria or something like that, but I'd really like to avoid that since at 11:30, for example, the numbers are much smaller. So if for some reason we max out at 9, maybe consider that. But we can do overflow if we have to. Hopefully the number will increase soon and we won't have to worry about that. I guess it depends on if we're all good and follow all our instructions, then please God, that will happen soon. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go in peace. St. Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our defense against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, thrust into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world, seeking to ruin the souls.
Our program, I heard the voice of Jesus.